Hello and welcome everyone to the Equity Master Investor Hour. I'm Sarit and I'm here with you again with our CEO, Rahul Goyal. Hi, Rahul.
Hi, Sarit. And it's wonderful to be back on the Investor Hour again. It's been a break.
Yes, we had a break, yeah. But we are back,
Mm-hmm.
And today we have with us our co-head of research, Rahul Shah. Rahul, hi, thanks for joining us. It's been a while since we spoke with you.
Hi, Rahul. Hi, Sarit. Yeah, it's been a while. I think the last time we spoke was in June 2020, yeah, when the environment was a lot different than it is today.
Yeah. Crazy. A different kind of crazy, I would
say. Yeah, absolutely.
So you can actually measure it in terms of cryptos. Probably June 2020, cryptos are taking off. And today when we are talking, cryptos are going down.
Can so happen in a matter of
one context to another.
It's amazing. Well, on that, I think my guess is as good as yours. No one can predict what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. But I believe that it's very important to have a certain strategy when you're investing in the stock market. You should have a certain framework of investing. If you don't have that framework, I think there's a tendency for you to get lost in the, you know, the news flow, the information flow. It's a mad jungle out there. And unless you have a well-defined strategy, mm-hmm, you're not going to be able to make sense of it. Mm-hmm. Now, you know, Warren Buffett, he said something very interesting at this year's AGM. In fact, he's been saying this for the past many years now. And he said that an average investor should not try to pick individual stocks. He should, mm-hmm, stick to an index fund. Mm-hmm. And that's a very important statement. Right. And I'll tell you why. You know, investing is easy and it's also difficult. It's easy because if you do nothing and invest in a basket of good quality stocks, the largest companies, something like an index fund, you will benefit from the growth in the underlying economy and the underlying corporate sector, right? I mean, historically, India has grown at 14-15% per annum. And if you invest in an index fund, you can get those kind of returns. Now, problem starts when we start shooting for the moon. We start expecting to earn, you know, 18, 20, 25, 30%. And that's very difficult because, you know, in the financial parlance, it is called as alpha, right? Generating alpha. So the index-like returns is where you get the beta, where you make market-like returns. And when you trying to outperform the market, you're trying to generate an alpha. You're trying to earn 3-4% more than the benchmark index. That's difficult because someone's alpha is going to be another person's negative alpha.
Yeah, stupidity.
Right? I mean, yeah. So if you're going to earn 20% in the stock market and the stock market is given 15%, there's some investor out there who's earning 10%. Mm-hmm. Your extra returns will come at the expense of other person's underperformance. And that's where it gets really tricky, right? I mean, you have so much of competition in the market. Everyone's trying to generate an alpha. You're competing against big data. You're competing against some of the best fund managers. You're competing against, you know, some of the smartest people out there. But this doesn't mean that generating alpha is impossible. For you to do that on a consistent basis over the long term, you need to have a sound strategy in place. Now, according to me, there are two ways of generating alpha. And you know, as a firm like, for a firm like Equity Master, and that believes in charging fees from its subscribers, it's imperative that we try and generate alpha from them, right? Otherwise, why would they need us? They'll straight away invest in an index fund. How do you generate that alpha and what is the strategy that you should use? To my mind, there are two strategies. One is you end up becoming a smarter stock picker than the average investor. You invest in better stocks, you do a lot of research, you burn the midnight oil and, you know, you sort of put in a lot of hard work. Another approach, which I think is simpler, it does not require a lot of IQ, but it requires emotional intelligence, is you don't make the mistake that the average investor makes. If you know the reasons why an average investor underperforms, and if you try and avoid those reasons, and if you take care of the downside, the upside will take care of itself. Mm-hmm. Now, what are the two common mistakes that an average investor makes? I think average investor is a terrible timer of the stock market, right? He'll invest in the stock market when everyone's going out or when, mm-hmm, you know, the market's already at their peak. Mm-hmm. And he will get out of the stock market when the stock markets have crashed. He'll get scared. Mm-hmm. If you do the opposite, if you have in your strategy a certain rule which allows you to invest in the market take maximum exposure to the stock market when the stock market is at its bottom or it's attractively valued from a long-term perspective, you've eliminated one of the major mistakes. So then you know the golden rule, Warren Buffett's, be fearful when others are greedy and greedy when others are fearful. So you, if you have some kind of system which allows you to be fearful when others are greedy and greedy when others are fearful, there you've eliminated one of the major mistakes that an average investor makes and which leads him to underperform. Second big mistake an average investor makes is he invests in stocks based on the popularity of the stock and not the valuation of the stock. If, you know, back in 2006-07, if the construction sector was very popular, he'll go ahead and invest in the construction sector. He'll not worry about the valuation of the company. You know, after that, real estate became popular. So these themes, the NBFC themes, these themes, we keep happening every few years. And investor ends up investing in those companies because those companies are popular and not necessarily undervalued. Mm-hmm. You have to ensure when you're investing that you're buying a company whose intrinsic value is 100 and you're buying it at rupees 80 or lower, right? If you buy based on undervaluation and not popularity, you again have an edge over the average investor. These are two mistakes that an average investor makes. He is a terrible timer. He must invest based more on popularity than valuation. So, you know, my aim with my strategies, the products that I run at Equity Master, is try and eliminate these two errors as far as possible. And this is what all my strategy is all about. Now, coming back to Sarit's question, what is my reading of the market? You know, a year back, I was bullish on stocks because the markets were attractive. Everyone was fearful and I turned greedy. Right now, it's opposite. The case is the opposite. The index valuation, the Sensex valuation right now is around 30, 31 times price to earnings trailing 12 months, which is in the 92nd or 93rd percentile, which means that only 8% of the time index has traded at expensive valuations than the current valuations. And more than 90% of the time it has traded cheaper than the current valuations. Of course, you can also account for the fact that the earnings are not normalized earnings. Mm-hmm. They have been disrupted because of the disruption that we're having in the economy. And you could account for that. And even then, I think the markets are expensive. So if you're having a rupees 100 right now, a good strategy would be to have 50 rupees or say 60, 70 rupees invested in cash and only 40, 50 rupees invested in stocks. A year back, I think the opposite was the case. If you had 100 rupees, it was a great time to invest 60, 70 rupees in stocks and only have 20, 30 rupees in cash. So these two major mistakes is, they form the fulcrum of my strategy at Equity Master, trying to avoid the two major mistakes that the average investor makes. They're terrible timers and they invest based on popularity and not based on valuation. If you take care of this, I think you would have gone a long way in achieving those market beating returns or generating alpha that you desire from the stock market.
So so now we won't ask you the question on Tesla. That's been answered. So I want to clarify one thing for the viewers. When Rahul said that India has traditionally grown at 14%, he meant a 6 to 8% real GDP growth and the inflation.
Absolutely.
It's a nominal growth of 14%. A lot of people miss that. So just to clarify. And I think that was a fascinating response, Rahul. It's very thought-provoking. And trying to do something better than the other person is always going to be more difficult because the other person could be getting better. But just not making the same mistakes as the others, it sounds a pretty simple thing to do. Sorry?
Yes, actually, that got me thinking, as in what are the mistakes that investors are making right now, Rahul? You said your strategy involves eliminating the mistakes that the average investor makes. So what are the mistakes that people are making right now?
Yeah, in today's context, yes.
So it's the same mistake of terrible timing, Sarit, if you ask me. 1979-80, Sensex was, 100, rebased to 100. Mm-hmm. Right now, 40 years later, we are at 50,000. That's 500 times. Sensex has been a 500 bagger in 40 years. 15-16% CAGR, and we've seen a lot of upheavals in the economy on the political front during this 40-year period. You know, we had the balance of payment crisis in the 90s, we had the Kargil, the Pokhran nuclear tests, of course, the 2001 attacks, a lot of disruptions in the economy, the subprime crisis in India as well. And despite that, we managed to have a 500 bagger as far as the Sensex is concerned. Now, it would have been almost impossible for an investor to not lose money during this 40-year period. But the average investor ended up losing money. Why did he end up losing money? Again, made the same mistake. When it was time to, you know, there's this famous saying that in the stock market, you cannot get good prices and good news. You can get only one, right? So if there's good news out there, which means that the prices are not good. If there are good prices out there, which means the news is not good. Mm-hmm. And you have to invest in an environment where the news is not good, when people are scary, and you have to, you know, take some money off the table when the markets go higher. These mistakes that people keep repeating again and again, I think I'm seeing a repeat of these mistakes again. A lot of people have entered into the stock market. You know, they want to trade left, right, and center. They want to earn alpha, which, as I just said, is very, very difficult to achieve over a long-term period. So, yeah, it's the same cycle, I guess, repeating over and over again.
Yeah. I think, Sarit, in India's case, I think global case, I think where money is flown is your tech stocks, right? The cryptos, a lot of money is flown there. And they are this momentum place. They're the popularity contest, right?
Yeah.
So whoever's on top, you buy it. And and the reverse is also true, right? The other day I was listening to, what's this guy's name? They call him the Bond King.
Gundlach.
And he said that not many people realize, but there has been capitulation in the 30-year treasury. So it's not just about speculating on risky assets. If you put in a whole lot of money in the 30-year treasury bond in the US, which is like the safest place to put your money, he says people have lost about 30% of the capital. So, you know, you could get the timing wrong in any asset. You have to just be careful. So people got so fearful, right? They went into the wrong asset class. They should have channelized it somewhere. And I think the other point which Rahul made is very interesting. And one has to note that even when you are getting greedy, you're not going 100% in stocks. You stopped at 60, 70. And even when you are fearful, you're not exiting stocks totally. So I know for a fact that's worked well for you, Rahul. But explain that whole concept of always having cash in your portfolio.
So I view investing as a game of probabilities and not certainties. Mm-hmm. So if you are not certain about a game, you're never going to be 100% in the game, and you're never going to 100% out of the game, right? Mm-hmm. No matter how low the valuations go, there's always something bad that can happen out there. So you always need that emergency cash, mm-hmm. You know, with you. So as to not wipe you out completely. So that 25% is very, very important irrespective of how low the valuations get. And again, on the upside, invest only to the extent of 75% in cash and not be completely out of the stock market, because markets can continue to be that famous John Keynes quote, right? It can continue to be irrational longer than you can remain solvent. So you never know. I think the 30 PE multiple of the Sensex is trading at right now. According to me, it's expensive, but market can remain at 30 PE multiples for 2, 3, 4, 5 years. Then what do you do in that case? You lose out on the entire upside.
Yeah.
By having that 25% in the stock market, at least you're able to, you know, capitalize on the
game. You've got skin in the game. Yeah.
So it's very important to, you know, not be completely in and not be completely out of the market and have at least 25% exposure to both the asset classes at any given point in time.
I like that approach, Sarit.
Yes, Rahul has had quite a bit of success with that approach. The 100 rupee concept that he mentioned, put only like 13 stocks right now and 17 something else. So, Rahul, is that what your system is saying right now? What is the split between that 100 rupees right now that you would recommend?
Yeah, so as I said earlier, across my services, I think I'm around 50-60% in cash and 50 the remaining in stocks. So it's an equal split right now.
I would love to see the comments on this video. It's going to, because it's so counterintuitive, right? It is so. Now, we know it's worked. We know it's worked across market cycles, but, you know, it's investor psychology, right? And I'm like, you know, I could play the devil's advocate and say, so that's so stupid, right? Why are you leaving money in the bank? It earns you nothing. put it to work, right? And that's when you make the mistake, I guess. That's when you buy into something you should not be buying, and that's when you end up with losses. So let's try and move a little forward on this. And so we've spoken about where we are today, right? And I think the signal Rahul is giving us is that the balance of probabilities suggests that things don't look great. But you don't want to be out of the game because you may be wrong. So you stay a little bit in it. We know that you've applied your system to a segment of the market which is traditionally considered to be speculative, right? So, and we know it's done well for you. But so tell us more about what you're thinking of penny stocks today. How does it look?
Sure. We started this penny stock service back in October 2018. And as I highlighted earlier, my two-pronged strategy, the entire 2019, I think we were sitting 70% in cash because the markets were expensive. We were not finding any opportunity to invest. We made very few recommendations, around 6-7 recommendations. And most of them, we had to close in the negative. But I was not worried because they constituted only 25-30% of the portfolio. Therefore, the loss was not much. And I was ready with cash to invest in stocks when an opportunity presents itself. And that opportunity came in March 2020, when the Sensex crashed 40% from the top and, the small cap index fell 60-70%. 60-70% is huge. A lot of good, decent quality companies, small cap, micro cap, penny stocks companies, they fell 70-75%. And I believe that that's a very good opportunity. And I started using my filters, my proprietary filter for investing in penny stocks, which I often highlight in my articles and in my videos. And that filter I started applying to penny stock companies. Mm-hmm. And I believe that you can make good money out of penny stocks if you take care of these, five elements of the filter. I call it the solid strategy, S-O-L-I-D, solid. Do not invest in a penny stock that's over-leveraged. On the balance sheet, at least 50 or more than 50% of the liabilities of the assets should be funded by equities, and only 50% less should by debt. So it should have a strong balance sheet. It should have owners that have skin in the game, or at least 30% ownership in the company. Long-term business viability. I should be able to conclude that the company should be around for the next at least 5, 7, 10 years. Mm-hmm. It should have a long history, and it should have products and services which the consumers want, and which it should be able to survive over the next 5, 6, 7 years at least. I stands for income generating. Over the last 10 years, I'm okay with the company generating a couple of years of losses, but it should be consistently profitable over the last 10 years. That's the I. And last but not the least is deep discounted valuations, which means that the company has a book value of rupees 100. It should be available at rupees 80 or below, or in terms of price to earnings multiple, it should be available at not more than single digit price to earnings multiple. Mm-hmm. These opportunities don't come often. They come every 1 to 2 years, and you have to be patient. 2 to 3 years, sorry. You have to be patient. And the opportunity came in droves in March 2020 when the markets fell 60-70% for the top. And I was sitting in cash. I invested, So 2019, if I would have made 6-7 recommendations, 2020 and 21, I've made close to 30 recommendations. Mm-hmm. So I try to take advantage of the opportunity as much as I can, and it has worked, wonders, wonderfully well for our subscribers. Yeah. They've earned a lot of money.
How large is the penny stock space? How many stocks in your universe, if I may ask?
It's very large. I think the last time I checked, there were more than 1,000 companies. The way I define penny stock is a company which is trading at rupees 50 or lower.
Okay.
There were more than 1,500 companies. But the investable universe, which pass all the five elements, all the five components of my solid filter, that will be 150, 200 stocks. So
That's not bad. Yeah. I think the all penny stocks get labeled as speculative. But if there is opportunity out there.
Absolutely.
And probably that's helped you tap into that space, because it's either speculative or there's very little solid research happening there. And you're applying your solid strategy. And this is the same thing that is inspired by Graham, did you say?
Absolutely. Yeah. So there's another important point I'd like to highlight here. Mm-hmm. Graham says that the biggest risk to an investor comes from buying below average stocks at the peak of the market. You can get away with buying good quality company at an expensive valuation because the company's quality is good. And sooner or later, it will give you returns. It will not give you very good returns. It will give you below par returns. But at least the 100 rupees that you've invested in the company, you'll get that back if you buy in a good quality company. Yeah, so, at the peak of the market cycle, I'm anyways not, 100 fully in penny stocks.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm only 50 or 25% in penny stocks. I've eliminated the risk of permanently losing, eroding my capital because I'm only 50 or 25% in stocks. The risk of that Graham talks about of investing in below average quality companies at the peak of the market cycle is eliminated. And at the bottom of the cycle, you have the cash to go headlong into penny stocks, buy good quality penny stocks when they're available by the dozens. So it works wonderfully well in terms of being able to buy good quality penny stocks as well. At the peak of the market cycle, you're avoiding those below average quality companies because you have that strict allocation rule. At the bottom of the market cycle, where a lot of good quality stocks are available at reasonable valuations, you're taking maximum exposure.
Yeah.
So that's another good point about the strategy, I guess.
Yeah. So this Graham approach, it's not very popular, right? Because I think there's a whole army of people who try and follow the Buffett approach to investing. And the Graham approach that you follow, it's a pretty rare approach, right? Or most people actually confuse what Buffett is doing as what Graham taught, right?
Yeah, so I've definitely seen more followers of Warren Buffett in India and, of course, the US also than followers of Benjamin Graham because it's exciting, right? Graham approach is a little boring. You tend to invest in dead industries which are not growing. And, people don't like it. People like exciting things, Bitcoin, Tesla. So Warren Buffett strategy that way is pretty exciting. You get to invest in the best quality names, You get to study things like competitive advantages in detail and stuff like that. But I think if applied properly, Graham's strategy is as profitable or I would say more profitable than Buffett's strategy. Just that it's a little... Yeah.
You've obviously shown that, so we know. Sarit?
Definitely, I think Rahul's strategy is better than both Graham and Buffett's.
It would be fair to say.
Yeah.
And you may have a reason to say that, right?
Yes. I was just
seeing some of the data. Yes, yes, go ahead, please.
Looking at the track record, yes, that's right.
Yeah.
Is it true, Rahul, that your last, 19 stocks have been on a winning streak?
2020 in the penny stock service, the last 20 positions that I've closed, I managed to close in the positive. But it's a bit of both, right? So before that, I closed about 5-6 positions in losses. So it's both a case of losing streak as well as winning streak. But the important thing is when the opportunity presents itself, you should take full advantage of it. Yeah.
And the allocation helps balance out the extremities.
Right.
So I like that approach. I could do that approach. Yeah. Follow that approach. Rather, I would follow Rahul's approach and be more disciplined. We could get more swayed by emotion. So we're talking Buffett and we're talking Graham. So Buffett just had his annual meet. What did you take away from that, Rahul?
So... My biggest takeaway from the meeting that it was a year of, I think, mea culpas for Warren Buffett. He admitted to making a lot of mistakes. He sort of made the Buffett fans feel good about themselves because they kind of put him on a pedestal and think that he could do no wrong. But at the end of the day, he's human and, he's also entitled to his fair share of mistakes. So he spoke about mistakes that he made in Apple, selling a small stake, which he shouldn't have sold. He did not invest at the market bottom. He thought the markets would fall more March 2020 when he had lots of cash. So he admitted to making that mistake as well. Mistake of selling airline stocks too early because he did not anticipate that, government would come in
pump
in money. So he admitted to making quite a lot of mistakes.
But I don't want to play contrarian here, but I genuinely believe that the balance of odds for someone with so much money at stake, right? I think what the right thing. I don't think anyone could have anticipated so much money will get pushed in the system and the vaccine will come out so fast. I think these two things are what stumped him. Otherwise, he played a safe game. He didn't do anything wrong. He played a safe game. And I'm sure he made a lot of money during the pandemic because of all his stakes in Apple and all that. Right. But the way it turned out was not good. And I think Charlie Munger gave an interview last year. When was that? Was that March or April or something? When he said that we would like to come out with more cash at the other end of this pandemic. Because that's the most valuable currency. I don't know. I kind of think that I think he didn't get it wrong. It's just that others got partially more lucky, if you will.
Absolutely. I think they did not anticipate that Fed and the US government would have learned lessons so well from the previous crisis. Previous 2007-8 crisis, they were a little late in coming to the rescue of the market. You know, they came to the rescue after the market had fallen 50, 60, 70%. This time around, you know, 20, 25, 30% fallen.
They came in.
Yeah.
All bazookas firing. So apart from the mea culpas, any other takeaway? I love the story you tell about that Samuelson book.
he feel a little out of touch with the current market environment, I think, which every value investor should. Given the kind of interest rates that are prevailing in the Western world, especially the developed markets. You know, the most important component in any valuation equation is the denominator, is the interest rate in the denominator of the equation, right? Lower that number, the higher the valuation. And I don't think he would have ever imagined that there would come a situation where the valuation of any stock would be infinite. You know, if the interest rate denominator becomes zero, the equation is practically infinite, right? I don't think he would have ever imagined the situation. And he also spoke about Paul Samuelson, the economics book that Paul Samuelson wrote, in it how he jokingly mentioned that we will never see a world where the interest rates would go to zero or even go to negative in real terms. But here we are, you know, 60, 70 years later, central banks have, you know, practically have no cost of money, zero interest rates. And you can, when interest rates are zero or close to zero, you can justify all kinds of valuations being given to companies because the denominator is essentially zero. For a value investor who's, you know, very particular about buying a 100 rupee note at rupees 80 by buying companies very cheap, he's, you know, this is the world that he did not imagine, I think. He has no idea of how long this madness is going to last.
So, the one thing that amazes me is that how versatile he is, right? Apple has become, what do you define Apple as in his annual report? One of the gems.
The greatest franchises, the greatest franchise, the greatest business on earth.
So how he's adapted to that, those businesses. I don't know whether he'll adapt to this new environment of these kind of interest rates or not. But yeah, you're definitely, he's fish out of water. He doesn't get this. And he's not pushing it. He's happy to stay back, collect all those monies. 130, 40 billion in the on the balance sheet now.
More than $100 billion.
He's just keeping it and taking in all the criticism. I don't feel them looking glum at all, Munger and Buffett.
But what he also said was everything has a cost, right? If you keep doing this, then there will definitely be a cost down the line. And how big that, you know, cost is going to be, you know, God knows. But
there's legacy to take care of. I guess. Sarit?
Yeah, that it also raises the question of value investing and, you know, how difficult it becomes when, you know, central banks can basically do whatever they want and you can print as much money at almost zero interest rates with almost no cost to them. That obviously raises the price of all assets around the world, stocks included. But value investors want to do something the exact opposite. You know, as Rahul said, you know, buy a 100 rupee note at 80 rupees. So they'll obviously end up with fewer and fewer opportunities the longer this goes on, this money printing. So does that mean that value investing is becoming harder, Rahul? I mean, what would you say? Is, I mean, how will you deal with this challenge?
So, you know, Ben Graham in Security Analysis, an intelligent investor, often speaks of the transition in the investor attitude that he's seen during his lifetime. You know, in the early 20th century, he said that people used to buy stocks only for dividends, no capital appreciation. They used to ignore capital appreciation. They used to buy stocks only for dividends. He later saw a shift where people wanted to buy stocks for capital appreciation. They give 50-50 importance to both. Half of the return should come from dividends. Half of the return should come from capital appreciation. Mm-hmm. Then came a time where people ignored dividends, only capital mm-hmm. appreciation. Then came a time where people forget company trying to maintain its earnings. People were looking at companies that were growing its earnings and yes. interested only in growth companies. Mm-hmm. And now we are seeing a time where companies are loss making and still commanding billions of dollars of valuations. Yeah. That's just the psychology of investing, right? I mean, how the psychology has changed from decade to decade or from one generation to another. But to me, the current attitude of investors, of giving massive valuations to those e-commerce companies and which are still loss-making, that's not sustainable because you need some business model. You need certain profits for which using which you arrive at the valuation of the company. Mm-hmm. How do I value a loss-making company that's making losses year after year? Of course, a lot of people will say that profits will come in the future. But value investing is based on facts. It's not based on opinions, right? It's based on certain standards. The fact is that the companies are losing money right now. They're not making any money. They're loss making. And a value investor cannot invest based on future promise that the company is going to generate profits some years into the future. That's certainly not what value investing is all about.
Yeah.
So, it's a difficult environment. It's getting difficult. Yeah. But,
and I think the example people give of Amazon, that it was loss-making and it turned a profit, it's just survivorship bias. Absolutely. Because for one Amazon, there must be a million other companies which were loss-making and they remained loss-making.
You hit the nail on the head, yeah, absolutely.
But that's the poster child, right, of this argument, that you have to invest for the future. And, slightly divergent, but if you look at Netflix, right, Netflix had the whole field to itself and they were killing it. They were making losses, but the size of the opportunity was so large. And now look what's happened.
Everyone's getting into the game.
Everyone. Yeah. There is no other business that's left. And suddenly the chance that Netflix has the market to itself has just shrunk. And if you bought assuming that all those losses will turn into huge profits, there's a question mark. On how much you'll make.
Some of the competitors have deep pockets in Apple.
Oh, yeah. Look at HBO. The other day, they merged just to fight the streaming wars even harder.
It's difficult and difficult. As long as you depend on outside capital, it's not a way to survive. You know?
Yeah. So here's the thing. If you, as an investor, are investing for the future, it's not to say that you should not take extraordinary risk for extraordinary return. But what the critical decision there is with how much capital you do it. So if you had 100 rupees, right, and you had 60, 70 rupees, 80 rupees in, or let's say 60 rupees, right? 60 rupees in rock solid, profitable companies, meeting all the criteria that you have, and you had another 25, 30 rupees in cash for opportunities and emergencies, and the rest is what you can do, do what you want to do with it. You want to go and buy a Bitcoin, go ahead and buy a Bitcoin. Just don't leverage it. Don't just leverage it, right? You don't want to lose more than 10%. And go and buy a crypto, buy a Ether. Doesn't Ether literally mean hover? Right, so whatever it is, I don't know. So go buy what you want to buy, whatever excites you. Investing doesn't have to be boring, but don't play with the future. I think that's where people get carried away, and that's when you see the big losses. In our day and age, we've seen the 99 TMT bubble, where people put all their money in TMT stocks. In 2007, though in subprime crisis, but in the stories I sort of saw very closely was where people had all leveraged in the F&O market. And that's why they made the huge losses. And this time around, it's the tech stocks, the loss-making tech stocks, and it's the cryptos to my mind. Speculating on Google is a very different ballgame because it's a very profitable company, right? You can speculate, you know, and probably the Graham principle will work out for you. You hold it for 20 years, you'll still come out ahead. But if you are speculating on Tesla, you're really doing something too exciting, maybe.
I mean, to have a market cap that's greater than combined of all the other companies, auto companies, it's crazy, I guess. And you're still struggling to make profits. The latest quarter, you made profit, but you made those profits, I think, trading.
The crypto gain. Crypto games, yeah, you're right.
Not earning anything from the core business, but your profits entirely coming from.
I think the stock year to date is probably down 35%, if I'm not mistaken. Or maybe more. At least 35% is down. So I think allocation is the key. And Rahul's got a system which allocates very smartly. Rahul doesn't talk a lot of macro stuff. So let's ask him a little bit of macro stuff.
Sure, Rahul. As in, you spoke so much about Tesla and, you know, the fact that it's down and all that. But is there any like big opportunity in the future, you know, Tesla-like opportunity that you're seeing right now in the Indian context?
Yeah, 100 bagger. Yeah, that's a simple question.
It's as a value investor, it's difficult to zero in on any such opportunity. So again, I'll go back to the Buffett AGM. At the start of the AGM, he had this beautiful chart about how if Berkshire had existed back in the early 20th century and knowing how the US was, you know, building these highways all across the country, the big opportunity would have been auto stocks. And at that point in time, there were, I think, 2,000 companies catering to the auto space. And to, you know, zero in on those 3-5 names, which you think should be, which you think would be the winners in the future, would have been absolutely next to impossible.
Yeah.
And he's, and I think he's bang on when he says that there is more to stock picking than figuring out which industry is going to have a wonderful future. Yeah. You have to figure out the companies that are going to benefit from that. And it's very, very difficult. It's not that easy. I think it's the same thing happening all over again. We're getting gung-ho about green energy, electric vehicles, about artificial intelligence.
Yeah.
And to pick a winner, of course, these sectors could become big going forward, but to pick a winner at the current juncture, it's, I think, very difficult.
Yeah.
If you have to do it with 10, 15, 20% of your capital, but the bulk of the capital should be, you know, allocated to sensible investing, to value investing, to growth at reasonable price, to investing in solid mode businesses. So the opportunity, you know, is there. We can say with some degree of confidence, you know, which industries will do well in the future or which are the sunrise industries. But to pick the winners is difficult, I guess.
Yeah. And,
you know, very hard, if you ask me.
The India's had a green stock that has done very well for whatever reason.
Yeah.
So I'm going to pick a question which Sarit has discussed with us. Is Rahul, what's more likely to happen first? Nifty 20,000? Or Nifty 10,000. And for those of you who are really long-term investors and don't track the markets daily, the Nifty is currently about 15,000.
So I'm more a tracker of the Sensex. In the term, Sensex term, that would mean around 65,000 Sensex. And
yeah, so take a Sensex of 50. Yeah. Take a Sensex of 50 and say, would it be 40 or 60 first? We are recording this and it will go down in for posterity to evaluate.
My heart says 60, but my, you know, my brain says 40. I would
That's like a very smart answer.
I'd like the price to fall to 40 before it goes to 60, because then I can allocate
then
the
you can allocate.
Cash.
Yeah. But there's too much liquidity in the system, right? I think that's what is concerning everyone. But for the fall to happen, something has to give, and if something gives so much money, everyone wants to buy the dip. Sarit, you have any...
Just to add to that, I think it's possible that even if it does fall to 40, you know, as you said, Rahul, there's so much liquidity floating around.
Yeah.
There'll be just too many people rushing in to buy, and then, you know, just before you know it, the Sensex will be back to 60,000. And everyone will wonder, like, what happened? Just like how it happened in March last year. Everyone thought, you know, it's you're going to have a huge 50% correction, but then
recovery. Timing the bottom is very, very difficult. What you could do maybe is every 20% dip, you allocate some money and put this to stops. That will be a better strategy in my view, because bottom is known only in hindsight. If you try to time the bottom, it's very difficult. No one has been able to do it.
So I know that Buffett and Munger always say that we don't make macro predictions, right? Mm. It's very difficult. But I believe that India will do very well in the future. I'm convinced it will do very well. This is not political. This is simply based on the fact that there's land, labor, capital. The environment is getting better. We are a young country. So naturally, we'll grow well. And if that's the macro environment and the chance of that happening is a relatively high degree of probability, then the risk of being out of the market is probably as high as being in the market, which basically means that you should not sell off and go away because the markets are high, because you may be missing out on the opportunity of a lifetime. So, and whatever that means, but I would say you should stay invested, but you should pick the right stocks, right? And keep that cash. The cash is what will do the cushioning for you at both the ends. If the story doesn't turn out, you had cash to buy it cheap. The story turns out, you got stocks riding on it. That's what I would say.
I think Rahul already has that cash buffer in most of his services. So
yeah.
I think from him, his point of view is just that getting his strategy absolutely bang on so that he can buy the right stocks.
Yeah.
And I think that system that he explained, the solid system, I think it covers most of the bases. I think he mentioned getting a strong balance sheet, earning income, and buying at a right price. I think it covers most of the basics that need to be covered.
Go ahead, please.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, what I'd like to say is, there is no strategy or no system which works well across all different kinds of markets. If someone's guaranteeing you that, you should just simply stay away from that person. Yeah.
So
the risk to my strategy is if we have a secular bull run, of 5-6 years where there is no bear market at all, my strategy will do well where, there's a bear market every 2 to 3 years, because then if I have the cash, I invest the cash in a bear market. But if there's a secular bull market, where for 5, 6, 7 years, the census just keeps going up and hardly ever has a correction, even if it has a correction, it's a small correction. And there's a risk that my strategy may underperform. It may, not do very badly, but it may underperform.
Yeah.
So it's always a good idea to diversify into different strategies, right? I mean, you have some person allocated to my strategy, some allocated to, growth strategy, which will tend to do very well in a secular bull market, momentum strategy.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, put your eggs in, not all your eggs in one basket, value investing strategy alone, but,
Put
it all your eggs in different baskets.
Yeah, I agree with that. That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
So, Ram, we've spoken of penny stocks as a bucket. Can you tell us one story from the penny stock space, one company that you've come across, done and dusted, packed it off, made money on it? Just tell us what an exciting story in that space, what we would not hear about, right? What kind of companies exist?
So, people think that cash bargains, companies where the working capital net of all liabilities is itself so high that the market cap of the company is trading lower than the working capital. If you assume the fixed assets of the company to have no value, if you take only the working capital, which is more liquid, and if you subtract all the liabilities from that, there were companies back in March 2020, I even ended up recommending 2-3 such companies to subscribers, where they were called as net nets, where they are so cheap that the market cap is less than the working capital on the balance sheet.
Wow.
You forget about the fixed assets. You're getting the fixed assets for free.
Free, yeah.
There were 2-3 such companies which I recommended to my subscribers, and they ended up doing well. I think we got some 70-80% quick gains in 4-5 months, and we got out.
What kind of business? I'm trying to get some color on that. What kind of businesses do they
do? This was a publishing company. Of course, people felt that one of which was a publishing company. People felt that, with the economy in lockdown, there'll be no schools and colleges for many months.
Many years, maybe school, college.
Could be, yeah. Many years. But the company was quite strong. It had a healthy balance sheet, did not have a lot of debt. Mm-hmm. And I realized that it was a good opportunity because the price was beaten down so low, mm-hmm. it had fallen below the working capital. So I ended up recommending the stock, and the stock did well. So these companies, every now and then you'll definitely come across these kinds of companies where the opportunity is so out there. And so
yeah, you would not find a publishing company in the large cap space, right? They used to be one or two, but they ultimately went under, I think.
Apparently, this company IPO'd 3-4 years back, and people were falling head over heels trying to get subscription to the company. At that time, there was a huge demand, but I felt that it was overvalued back then. Yeah, from there,
it's not an open position, right? Can you tell us the name?
Yeah, it's S. Chand.
S. Chand. Oh, yeah. Chand. I'm sure we bought a book or two from
Yeah. So I think fell some 80-90%. It was crazy from the top.
Oh, wow.
I thought that was ended.
I think it's one of those examples where the market just goes completely irrational in certain cases. Yeah. And you can make like very easy profits if you know what you're doing. Mm-hmm. But Rahul, what about an average case? Among all the positions that you have sold at a profit, what has been the average return for any stock? And for how long did you have to hold on to these stocks?
So past 1.5 years, I think gains have come in really thick and fast. I guess the average gain, I've not done a detailed study, but off the top of my head, I guess 70-80% in 6 months.
Okay. That's a lot.
Yeah, it's a fast moving market. But I think what is to be appreciated more, Sarit, is that it came in without taking extraordinary risk.
Yes.
Yeah. You didn't play the momentum. You didn't buy the Tesla and you're not riding a wild horse. You actually bought the value stocks. That means you didn't take much risk and you still made that.
Yes.
That was good. You slept peacefully.
Yes, good. Yeah. All the returns have come without the volatility that small caps usually see. Small caps have had a wild ride last 2-3 years.
Yeah.
It's gone up and it fell 60% from the top, but none of this has happened in my service.
You are well placed to answer this round. Aren't small caps still relatively cheap?
Yeah.
As a basket, yeah. Mm-hmm.
I would say so because one way of figuring out whether the small cap space is still attractive is how many stocks are trading below book value, small cap companies.
Okay.
So, the universe that I look at, March 20, April 20 last year, I think there were around 250 to 300 companies that were trading below book value. That number has come down to 100, 125.
Okay.
So that's not bad. When alarm bells should start ringing when the number falls to 30, 40 names. But that's not happened. So from that perspective, I guess the small cap space is still attractive, if you ask me.
Yeah. And did you all see that data that the current rally until the last couple of days where FI was really supported by the retail investor? Was that a little unnerving and for you guys? It's only the retail guy who's buying, but the institutions had all gone away from the market. Did you see that?
To be honest, I don't pay attention to these factors. As long as I buy undervalued companies, whether they buy it at the other end, be a retail investor or institutional guy.
I love that approach. It takes away so much clutter. It flashed on my screen a couple of days back, and I'm like thinking, is that a sign? I think it was picked up in one of our trading alerts. That the retail guys are leading the rally. So
quite possible. I think the number in the US, the data point that Graham and Buffett pointed out, 14% of all F&O trading on the Robinhood app is driven by millennials who are just investing in futures and options with the 7-day holding period.
Yeah.
Something similar could be happening.
There is any millennial watching this podcast, which is highly unlikely by now because we haven't spoken of much racy stuff, and not to sort of categorize you all as one, I think the message you should take is investing is very simple, but it's not easy.
It's not easy, absolutely.
Please, I think, it's not. Well, that's all I would say to the millennials who are still listening in, if at all. Okay, I think we are nearly out of time here. Sarit, you want to ask your favorite questions?
Rahul, you're a very well-read person. So I always want to get your view on what is the latest, in your library, what is it that you're reading right now?
So I have a clear rule, you know, outside of work hours, I make sure that I don't read anything about investing.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah. So these days I'm reading a lot of ancient Greek philosophy, you know, Socrates, Plato, people like Aristotle. And it's fascinating. They have so much to teach us. I mean, you know, I like the approach of Socrates who says that an unexamined life is not worth living. I think it's a fantastic quote. And what Socrates used to do is he used to, you know, back in Athens, in Greece, he used to just stop any random person on the street and ask, start having a conversation with him, ask him some very profound questions like what is virtue, you know, what is honesty, what is ethics, and they used to have this wonderful debate back and forth, and they used to come to some beautiful answers and you know, musings about life. And with technology, so much you know, at our fingertips these days, I think you can do something similar. If you're not out there walking on the streets and trying to stop a person, you can use the internet, and you know, any deep profound question that you have, you just type into Google, and you have all the answers at your fingertips. But keep, you know, examining, you know, keep asking these deep profound questions to yourself and try and get answers to those. So as he says, an unexamined life is not worth living. Then there's, you know, Plato, he has so much to teach. I love his allegory of the cave. You know,
a
story that he keeps talking about how if you have to see the light, or if you have to, you know, take a non-contrarian approach, how you have to climb out of the cave and see the sunlight. If you're trapped in a cave, you know, all you're going to see is myths and stories which other people tell you. But if you have to find out the fact, you should climb out of the cave. So these are wonderful fables that these philosophers have passed down upon to us, and it's fascinating. It's a fascinating read.
Yeah, there's the other popular book, right? Meditations by Marcus Aurelius.
Yeah,
that's also pretty thought provoking.
Absolutely.
Archimedes, who was the guy who said that? Give me a place to stand and a lever long enough, I can move the world. Was it
Archimedes?
I remember reading that long ago. Yeah,
there's a lot of wisdom, I think. Yeah, there's a lot of wisdom that these people have to teach us. It's fascinating.
Yeah. We should ask Rahul for the name of the book if he doesn't remember offhand, and we should link it from the podcast.
Yeah,
if you can get that book.
So these days it's more of YouTube videos and, you know, philosophy podcasts rather than books.
Okay. Makes sense.
Rahul, are there any blogs that you keep reading repeatedly that you would like to recommend to our viewers and listeners?
So yeah, there are quite a few. I love Morgan Housel. I hope I pronounced the name correctly. Collaborative Fund. I think one of the finest financial writers that we have. I love Howard Marks's letters that he writes, memos to his investors.
I'm sure you were not very excited by his last one, where he had a debate with his son-in-law on value. Did you like that?
In a way, he was right. I guess he meant that if you're investing in the high tech space, don't speculate. Invest in proven names.
Yeah.
Facebook, which sort of Warren Buffett even corroborated. He said that these companies are not expensive given where the interest rates are.
Yeah.
Companies like Facebook, Google, you know, Apple, they may seem expensive, but given where interest rates are and given how strong franchises they are, perhaps there's a case to
invest in those. His memos are good. I just found that one to be too long and boring, but otherwise his memos are very, very thoughtful. Yeah. Mm-hmm. What else are you reading?
There are usual value investing websites like, you know, acquirersmultiple.com, which have snippets from interviews and podcasts, which I think are very fascinating.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's gurufocus.com, value investing website devoted to value investing. So these are the four findings that, you know.
Yeah, we'll link all those. So the
yeah, we'll can definitely popular. Link yeah. all those. And yeah. it's always good to ask Rahul this question, because we always come to know of some random website which we never knew about
before. Yeah.
like Acquirers Multiple. I didn't know this something like that existed. Yeah. I'll definitely check that out. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So basically I'm done with most of my questions. I think all of them.
Rahul, I think we've run through our list. Rahul, is there anything that you would like to talk about that we didn't sort of nudge you on?
No, I guess we've covered pretty much everything, I guess.
Disclose you're a big holder of cryptocurrencies like Bill Miller, another value investor.
Yeah. Do you have a secret crypto portfolio? Wrong question.
He wouldn't be smiling so much. It fell sharply last night.
I actually had half a temptation of investing in Bitcoin. You know.
Yeah, you did.
Absolutely. Uh-huh. But now I'm seeing the kind of volatility that it's witnessing. I think.
Anyway,
I was only planning to invest a small amount, not.
And then you can buy the Dogecoin or Doge.
I think it's safe to say that Rahul does not have a crypto portfolio.
Yeah, safe to say.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyways, so that was a wonderful conversation, Rahul. As always, very thoughtful, very thought provoking. And there were so many points to take away. Some that struck right at the outset were, just don't make the mistakes other people make. I think that's such a simple yet powerful way to approach investing. And I think that's left a mark. And there were so many other moments which were thoughtful. And I think our viewers will find them extremely stimulating, intellectually stimulating. Sarit?
Absolutely. I think Rahul covered a lot of heavy topics like, you know, what kind of stocks to look at, what kind of system he follows, you know, the mistakes to avoid. I think if people watch this video, I think more than once you'll you know, pick up things that you probably missed out on the first viewing. So it's you covered quite a bit of depth, Rahul. So I'd like to thank you for the effort that you put into answering all of the questions.
And this will also go down in history as the best.
Thank you
dodge.
For this opportunity.
Yeah. This will go down in history as the best dodge. Will the Sensex go to 60 or
40?
My heart says this. My head says this. Yeah. So on that note, Rahul, thank you very much on this Investor Hour, and we hope to have you soon again.
It's always a pleasure.
It's been wonderful.
Yeah, chat with you and sir. It's always a pleasure. Thank you so much for having me.
Thanks so much for joining us, Rahul. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.